in verse 21 or verse 20, the rich young ruler asked Jesus this question, what lack I yet? I believe that's a good question for all of us to ask the Lord. Some of us may already know within ourselves what areas of our lives aren't fully given over to God. And so it seems like though this rich young ruler was hungry for the things of God in terms of being all in. And Jesus, of course, being the Almighty, could identify where his place, his need place was. Of course, he didn't have economic needs or natural needs. His need was what he lacked in God. I think it's always appropriate for us to understand there are three things that are important in terms of our pilgrimage here on the earth. Number one, you know that in Genesis 1, 26, the Lord says, I mean, let us make man in our image after our likeness. That's followed up in Romans 8:29 says, whom he did foreknow, then he also did predestinate to be conformed to the, again, image of his son. So transformation is huge in terms of this lifetime. We're going to live 70 by reason of strength, 80 or even longer, but the issue is not longevity. The next one then is destiny. You are and I are called to be like God, Christ in us, the hope of glory. When people see us, they should get some sense of the reality of who God is through us. Our lives are more than just natural. The Bible clearly says we're in the world, but we're not of the world. It says further in Philippians, we have our conversation in heaven, meaning that the impetus in our thoughts, words, and deeds come from another realm or another world. I would say we're being challenged with that today because it seems as though some are saying that America is post-Christian because it seems like we're trying to bring God into our world rather than understand he made us for his world. Everything about it, Psalms says in Psalms 24, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. This is God's world and we belong to God. So the prayer is, God, not our will, thy will be done. We couldn't give him one good suggestion that didn't emanate from him. And so secondly, destiny. And then the last one would be legacy. Today, we often define ourselves by the plaudits of men. I was just thinking that when I first started ministry there in Richmond, Virginia, the idea was win them, train them, send them. Win them to the Lord, train them, disciple them, and then send them somewhere. The idea was that I'm raising up sons and daughters so that if I were not there, they would be able to carry on. Nowadays, when you start listening to many of the speakers, it's win them, count them. Win them, count them. Win them, count them. It's now how many? Instead of leading people into a communion with God, into an authenticity, into a reality of a prayer life that really is reaching heaven, it seems like now our credibility comes with how many we have coming in, not how many are willing to give up everything and go out. This is what we're seeing right here, because the Lord identified with this man's need, and he says to him, if thou wilt be perfect. Now, I really think that there's a lot of people who even are thinking like that. But he says, go and sell thou hast and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. And, of course, he didn't do that. It says he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. And I would say to you that he didn't just have great possessions. The possessions had him. He didn't do what God Almighty said. This was Jesus. This was Emmanuel. This is God in the flesh. He had the opportunity to become a disciple. He chose money. He chose the temporary rather than the eternal. And I say that in America, we still have an issue with that today. And I could go into it in some detail if I had a moment, but I have to go on. Verse 25, it says, and when his disciples heard it, they were exceedingly amazed, saying, who then can be saved? And then Peter in verse 27 says, then answered Peter and said unto him, behold, we have forsaken all and followed thee. What shall we have therefore? And then Jesus defined for them what all was. And he said to Jesus, said unto them, verily I say unto you, that ye which have followed me in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, you shall sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone that hath forsaken, then he named it, houses, brethren, sisters, father, mother, wife, or children, or land, for my sake and for my name's sake, shall receive a hundredfold and shall inherit everlasting life. And so that he finds what all it is. And that would mean that you put Jesus before any of that. So then I'm talking to you guys about this last week. I go into Tom Phillips' office in the library, and he starts telling me about Germany. And while he was telling me about Germany, he said Germany was in a free fall. And he said the only thing that's saving it right now is Syrian Christians and the Nigerian church plant effort. He says, Wellington, I believe that if you go to Germany and would plant there, you can make a difference. And in some ways, if you made a difference in that country, you would be even accepted even greater here in America. Now, he didn't know, he didn't have the slightest idea that I finished high school in Germany. Secondly, I met my wife in Germany. Thirdly, I took German and probably could pretty, I'm already doing my, anyway, I got my Kindle tutor back again. Guess what? I go to another, so then I said, baby, we really need to consider that. She says, you're right, we need to consider that. That is the first time my wife ever considered, you're talking about leaving the grandchildren, leaving the children, leaving the United States. You said, moving there? She said, exactly. So here I am now, I've mentioned it to one church since I left Thomas, since I left you. I said, well, I'm gonna have to go by myself. My wife's not gonna be able to go, I'm not gonna be able to afford to take both of us going over there, staying with someone at the time until I find us another house. He didn't know we just sold our house, we just downsized. We were thinking about buying a house in America, but I did make up my mind, I'm not gonna give up and go to the end of my life sitting on the back of the bed looking at Hallmark movies. I know I wasn't going out like that. You're gonna go out on fire. So, but I didn't think it was gonna be like this. So I mentioned it to the church, can't take my wife. The next morning, a businessman that was at the church called me up and said, your wife's supposed to go with you. My wife and I prayed about it, we're gonna give you the money for your wife to go with you first class. My wife then said, I told you I was gonna go. He puts her hands on her head. She says, see, I'm the first one to get a senior to going anyway. So she's going. The next church I mentioned it, about we're looking at going to Germany. A businessman came up to me and said, I was with you 22 years ago. You were going to do that 22 years ago, don't you remember? I was gonna be the one you were gonna send over there to open Germany up. You know, I'm doing well right now. I'm gonna buy both of your tickets while I'm here. Do something else with the other money you've been getting. I said, oh my God. Then he said, we're gonna stay over there. How long? What do you want to go? I said, November, just go ahead, let's go ahead and see right now. Bought me the ticket, sent the ticket to us November the 13th to December the 12th to find our location. Then I said, where are we gonna stay? Somebody else said, I'm gonna take care of you staying in the Hilton Hotel near Frankfurt for the month that you're gonna be over there. People, let me tell you something. We are out here, I am going to Germany. So, I just turned 69, you know, I said, look, but this is what's true. All the times I was speaking in Promise Keepers, the times I spoke before the National Salvation Army, global meetings, you know, Southern Baptist Convention, all these places, I was halfway, like, my hip, I had both knees and both hips replaced. But look, I've been saying, this is the best I felt in 25 years. I mean, I had something. So, I said, why am I this strong? Because Germany is the destiny. So, then, since I was over at a building, at a ministry, the third church that where that person gave me the money, the pastor brought me back to the office and said, look, I have a gift of knowing what buildings you're supposed to get before you get it. Are you going to need it? I said, yes, we're going to need a building, we're going to set up, it's going to be a place for the Lord, so we're going to train people like Schaefer did, and that kind of thing, and leaders that go in, like all of Europe. He said, your building is going to have blue on it. It's a warehouse-type building, and you're going to know. So he explained to me how three different four different, he gave you four examples of it, but his wife, his staff sentences has a gift for that. I get over to where I'm going right now. They give me a diagram. But God says, oh, I know someone that lives in South Africa. My daughter lived in South Africa for 15 years. That has a building in Germany. And that person that is the one that has been commissioned to get rid of this building is here right now in Charlotte right now. We went to the meeting, and here I'm going to send you a picture of what the building looked like, and here is the blue on the building. I said, oh my God, what is going on here? This thing is happening fast. Well, I want to say that I got to really watch what I preach and watch who I hang around, because it could be that my only my destiny, my location is going to change. Maybe God is calling you to some place that in your mind you haven't thought about, or in your physical situation, you know, I don't know if I can do this. Well, it's really not a matter of whether you can do it, it's whether God has summoned you to do it or not. Three things: you're called to be like Him, two, you're called to destiny, and three, you're called to legacy. The last verse of the Old Testament would end it like this: you hold out in that great temple of the Lord, I'll say, Elijah the prophet. And you'll turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to the fathers, lest I smite the earth with a curse. If there had been no New Testament, the last word of the Old Testament would have been cursed. The exact reason is that there was no generational transfer. People are saying, what are we going to do with the millennials? What do you mean, what are we going to do with the millennials? They're your children. You raised them. You were called to do something with them. We're going to do something with the children. We're going to do something with the nations. God bless you.